homage to the orchestrator of all of this, which is the Holy Spirit. Homage to the root guru. For me, the root guru, Jesus Christ. Homage to the transmission guru, Longchenpa. Homage to the big boost guru, Sri Sri Anandamayi, and homage to the inspirational guru, Ramana Maharshi. Very simple. I understand this situation and how it is that this all works together. The Holy Spirit orchestrates it all. It's really all the Holy Spirit, but there's these qualities we call these different Dharma kings, Jesus Christ, the root guru, who laid it all out, who broke all the ice, laid it all out, made it absolutely, you know, clear what the whole situation is all about. But when you're trying to get the actual experiences of it, what happens is you try to put it back into some sort of Christian conceptual framework or something, and it's too difficult for me. So along comes the transmission guru, Longchenpa, no baggage, don't even know who he is, and just pow, there's vision of intrinsic spaciousness. I just say, oh, okay, I love this. What's this? I could see it's intrinsic spaciousness. Wow. Just wow. Okay. And so he's been transmitting these experiences that A Course in Miracles, Jesus Christ, Holy Bible, Jesus Christ, laid out the whole explanation for it all. So we could clearly say, ah, okay, I get it. This is really it, in spite of what anyone might say. So there's no need to put it into much context. You just wow it with the transmissions with Longchenpa. Now, there are certain areas, difficult points, that prevent us from, that keep us stuck, and no matter what happens, we just spin on our wheels. Along comes the big boost guru, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma. And she has this touch that is able to move us past these areas that for some reason are just, we keep getting in our way, and the teachings, the transmissions, the root guru, whatever, we keep getting in our way. She somehow is able to boost us past this. And then the inspirational guru, whenever I feel like tired and down, I go to Ram Maharshi. It's like, he doesn't ask anything from us. It's just, it's just so nice. It's like a comfortable couch, Ram Maharshi. I just, I'm so inspired by him. This is how I work. This is what works for me. The root teaching is A Course in Miracles, and for sure, and which is really just a clarification of what Jesus taught in the Holy Bible, actually. But that was used such twilight language, esoteric twilight language and symbology that along the way it's you know, thousands of years, it's gotten pretty muddy. And so he came back and said, okay, look, this is exactly what I was talking about, and put it in a clear vernacular. It's not so much a twilight language at all, actually. Of course, Miracles, no twilight language there. He just laid it out very clearly. So we say, okay, that's what you're getting at. Wow. Eternal life right now. You don't have to die for eternal life. And of course, in Miracles, is Journey Beyond Words, where he laid it out even more clearly. And so that's like the root scriptural teaching, you know, the root teaching is from Jesus, really. And then Longchenpa comes along and just, pow, there's the experience. He transmits it. He transmits the experience that we're aiming for, the vision of oneness. It's like, oh my gosh, isn't that great? So it's wonderful how they all work together in concert, and the grace of God comes at from different angles. You know, doesn't allow us to get stuck. Doesn't allow us to spin our wheels too much. I see those who are just using one approach, I see them spinning their wheels a lot. I really do. I prefer the ecumenical approach. I believe it's more effective. These various Dharma kings have different qualities, different ways of grace that can really dispatch a problem for us in a certain way that we're amenable to. So I use all of them, absolutely use all of them. And I use all of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's orchestrating every little thing. It's just as you go along in your life, it's always, always present, seemingly. You know, your attention on this, your attention on this, and it's just the great orchestrator of everything. All grace orchestrates all grace. Now, just before I taped here, had a little clumsy incident here where I didn't center the computer on its glass stand here properly. I don't know why. Well, I do know why. And it slipped off and things fell and everything rolled around and a bottle fell and hit the ground and broke. So I said, okay, you know, no problem. And I swept it all up, hopefully got all the glass up. And things were too crowded here, so I uncrowded them is what I did. But the problem was, I'm tired. That's why I was clumsy. I'm really tired. So let me go into this and lay out sort of the groundwork of your path. I'm very super confident here. Yes, a crisis is coming. Okay, terrible crises are coming. But tremendous transmissions are coming. The transmission Dharma King, Longchenpa, is really hitting it. Okay. He's really hammering it. And I had another transmission today. Part of the transmission, the dream that I had, where I saw I got this feel of the oneness. There's only one life. There's not many lives. There's just one life. This is really very profound, and you can't really explain it. You try to stuff it into some explanation, you're going to lose it. So just allow the transmission Dharma King to do his thing. It works. Just call on him. He will do it. He's giving transmissions now. This is very exciting. Growing up, as I did in the 60s, 70s, and there were so many gurus giving transmissions then at that point. And you know, we all wanted to get these transmissions. It was just like, maybe if I just get this transmission, I will get it. And so it is so exciting to be actually getting transmissions from this Dharma King. Okay, from this total guru, this great Satguru, this Dharma King Longchenpa, who merely by walking past you in a dream gives you these transmissions. You get these transmissions from him. So please feel free to ask him for a transmission. This is what he does. He would love to give you a transmission. And there's no special laying on of hands and chanting or nothing. He just says hello or just stands next to you quietly. You might have a little quiet conversation. He just say hello, walk past you. That's it. That's all it takes. And we know from Jesus that's all it took when he was in the Holy Land, right? He just walked past people. They just catch a glimpse of him, touch the hem of his garment, whatever. Boom. Leprosy. Gone. So everybody was wanted to get a transmission from Jesus at that time. You just in this vicinity, you would get that. What is this? Okay. Okay, no problem. And so Longchenpa, same thing, except he does it in dreams. He can do it in dreams. He does it in dreams right now. Now, I'm not saying the others can't do it. Absolutely they can. But as I said, it helps a lot if there's no baggage attached to the experience, the transmission you're having. It's just experience. Say, oh, wow, okay. And you don't feel like you have to explain it in Christian terms or something. I mean, how do I explain in Tibetan terms? I don't know. I just vision of intrinsic spaciousness, clear light vision, intrinsic space, or it's just the one life. Just the one life. There's no, but if I say, well, Jesus gave me this, you know, transmission, and he told me the one life, and then people will start trying to say, okay, explain it in Christian terms, and how do they historically, and what, blah, 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 blah. It's like, and I feel like, oh my gosh, they're panicking. How do I do this? But I just say, well, you know, this Longchenpa walked past me in a dream, and the next day I had this just experience of just the one life. That's all. I say, oh wow, I'm just in this transmission mode. I've just received a transmission. It makes it easier. Now, this is just what's happened. I can't explain it. This is just what has happened with my life. I spent most of my life with Jesus, of course, and been with A Course in Miracles for 38, plus years, and Journey Beyond Words for 22 plus years. But these other Dharma kings who are playing a part to help speed me along, to go fast, really fast. Now, so we are in a very super confident mode here because we're getting transmissions. Longchenpa is in the house and he is giving transmissions. So we are in a super great place. And I want to emphasize this. I mean, here I am driving along and I just start to consider a certain way that there's no definition at all. Okay, there's nothing is defined. Reality is totally indeterminate. Totally indeterminate. And then I just got the sense that, oh, okay. So there's no my life, your life, this life, plant life, this life. It's just one life. That's all it is just one life. And I was just like, wow. But really, all day today, I've been having these huge wows. From this, this dream of Longchenpa walking past and hailing me. And it's just, somehow he transmits this confidence to you. Just this pure certainty and confidence that so nonchalantly. It was like, it's because there's no baggage there. It's not like, oh, there's Jesus. Oh my God. Jesus, I remember you in the Holy Land. Oh, I'm asking you some questions about, what happened to Mother Mary and what are the, there was this guy walking by high rise. Like, oh, huh? Who are you? Like, what? Oh. Experience. So it's so much easier. It's so much easier that way. I don't have to ask him about Mother Mary, Were you really crucified? And what happened? And we want to ask Jesus all these questions. What happened really in your life? I mean, because constant buzz about this, and this is on purpose to distract people. There's so much controversy. They stirred up so much controversy about Jesus. We want to say, Jesus, can you just straighten out all this stuff for me so I can tell people what's what? But if you try to tell anybody about Jesus, then you're going into a hornet's nest. I don't care, what you say. But, I mean, like, I didn't even know hardly about his life at all. Just a guy. And so I don't really have any questions for him, actually. I just say hi, that's all. My experience of him has just been, I got an experience, I get experiences from him, transmissions, that's it. Now I've read, a couple of translations of his books, but it's pretty much, just this heartfelt, hey, life is beyond attainment and non-attainment. That's pretty much it. Life is beyond attainment and non-attainment. Non-attainment is the attainment of pure presence, but really, pure presence is beyond both attainment and non-attainment. And the one life, just the one. And so it's so abstract. It's just so abstract what he's saying. And so it's just I'll just take the transmission. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. So we're in a time of now transmissions. And when those transmissions start happening to anyone, it's going to start spreading out. It's going to start rippling out. So we're in a super great position right now. Really are. So to celebrate that, I say, start to live well right now. Live well. Don't be all contracted. Don't be contracted. Now I'm still dieting. I'm still working out like nobody's business. And that's why I was clumsy, because I was working out this evening. I mean, I'm sore every morning and every day. It's wow, but I keep doing it. And this, wow, this one was really something. I started skipping. I did 5 circuits around here, skipping, just skipping. And then I started skipping where I hop twice on one leg and then go to the other and hop twice. And then I started doing 3 hops. You want to burn. You just try that. And then I also have something I'm going to do, which is just going sort of sidestepping around circuits, sidestepping circuits, going sideways kind of around the whole, first leading with the left foot and then switching leading with the right foot. Wow. You talk about a workout. And you know what? I just realized I never see adults skipping. When's the last time you saw anyone skipping? It's children, right? But I was skipping. I was just doing beautifully. Wow. I said, wow, this is cool. This is really, really cool. How about that? When's the last time you saw an adult skipping down the street? You just don't see it. Why not? I love skipping. The arms are up, you just feel like you're prancing and skipping along. It's such a carefree, it gives you this carefree feeling. It absolutely changes your mood, skipping. So if you're in good enough shape to skip, I very much recommend skipping. Just do a circuit around your apartment, your house, or wherever. I didn't want to go out in the street doing it because people say, "What the heck is he doing an adult skipping down the streets? It's crazy. What is that?" So I didn't want to scare the horses, so I stayed out of the view of the neighbors and everything. But I did it, and I was doing all sorts of exercises. What was I doing? A whole bunch of different exercises now. So suddenly, the whole exercise program has suddenly shifted. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. It gets me to do some stuff. I say, okay, great, now I'm doing this. And it says, oh, now you're doing good. Okay, now we're going to shift to this one because this is going to push you even further. I say, but I haven't finished with this one. The Holy Spirit said, there's no time. Go, you got to go. You got to start skipping. Ah. Oh my gosh. So. But that's not all I did. I did all sorts of swinging heavy stuff like this. Oh my gosh. T work sore the whole body. But I stretched all this morning. I did abs. I did tremendous amount of ab work this morning. Leg kicks and rolling on the roller. It just absolutely hit every part of my body today, actually. So I'm just like clumsy. So I really made this smoothie, which was one of the 2% Faya yogurt, just a whole blob, whole like I don't know, it was almost a cup of it or something. A strawberry protein drink from Odwalla, then a whole cup, at least a cup or not more, of strawberry kefir. Life was it Life Away or something like that? Life Away kefir, strawberry kefir. And then two big scoops of chocolate whey protein powder. And I just started hammering that smoothie. I guess still got at least half of it left or more. Because I need protein. I need to recover from this. My body is almost like in the shock from the stress of what I'm doing workout wise. And then plus I sang all day and taped all day driving. So this has been going on every single day. I'm all day long I'm either singing or talking. And then the rest, and then I'm skipping rope. I'm doing exercise, and then I'm taping in the evening here for 2.5 hours. So plus working, for 8 hours a day, and not getting much sleep. This is living right, isn't it? This is the grand life. What better life is it than this? And getting dreams and from Longchamp and getting transmissions during the daytime. I mean, who's living a better life in the world right now than I am? I question anybody. And I'm going to enjoy a Kavita coconut. This stuff, if you haven't tried it, I don't know if you can even. It's going to show up. Kavita, yeah, Kavita coconut. It's a probiotic drink. And it is good. It is really good. And I'm taking some supplements. I take a refrigerated probiotic. I just got some ginkgo biloba. The Holy Spirit one had me do this. It was in a store. Just said, here. Like, what? What is this? I don't know. Wants me to take some of those. I'm taking some, vitamins for my eyes. My eyes are not so good. I'm just doing all this stuff, living the grand life, because why not? Why not? We're headed for something really great. Wow. It's got that soury taste, but it's blended properly with the flavorings and the coconut and everything. That it's good for sipping, and it's fizzy too. It's really good for sipping. Plus, you're getting the probiotics. So, what are I'm getting the probiotics from here. I'm getting from the Greek yogurt. I'm getting from the kefir. And I've got the little capsule, gel and capsule of probiotics from the fridge. So, I'm doing like four different varieties of probiotics. Just it's just you know just habit. It's just plus oh well plus kale smoothie in the morning, kale smoothie in the in the evening before you go to bed, with Vita One protein powder. So, I mean, this is ridiculous, right? But I need it. Plus, I'm losing weight under my weight. I need it just to keep exercising like I am. I'm really pushing myself. Not too much, but I am sore. So I do a lot of stretching. When I go to a gas station, I'm always stretching. Always stretching. Use your downtime when you're filling your car up. Do all these stretching exercises and stuff. And just really keep stretching yourself. Keep stretching yourself. So this is just part of the grand life. You see, when you're getting transmissions from a transmission from a omniscient Dharma king giving transmissions, how you know how, what do? Well, you keep on trucking. You keep your habits going. You keep exercising. You keep eating right. You keep all your good habits going. Avoid the bad ones, and that's what you do. And so it helps stabilize you. When you get transmissions, you just need to just keep your stride going. Okay, I saw today. I felt there's just one life. That's all there is, and that's God. That's called God. The one life. The one life. Just one mind. One life. That's it. Okay. Wow. And get home and start exercising, and then do and making dinner or whatever, and doing stuff, and just to keep your habits going, your good habits. You just keep your good habits going. It's not like, oh my gosh, I had a good tra I had this transmission. Now I need to start a whole bunch of good habits. No, that's not the way. You need to have the good habits already very secure, and then the transmissions come, and you just keep on with your good habits. That's all. This is the secret to it. So don't say, "Well, I'll start my good habits once I get a transmission. I realize that God's really God, and then I'll, But not until then. That's upside down and backwards. Start, keep your good habits, have the grand life going for yourself, and then the transmission, they'll fit right in. You say, "Okay, wonderful. It's cool. It's cooled down in California. So where did summer go? Summer's disappeared suddenly. It was a and then blast of summer, and now it's just gone. It's cool, cloudy, cool, beautiful day. So just very, 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 with the cloud, the nice clouds, and the breeze and everything. Wow, what a beautiful June day today was. I ordered a Beach Boy, the Beach Boy CD. I can't find all the ones. I used to have every CD. I don't know what I did with them. I may have given them away. But I ordered one. I tried singing, and I could sing the falsetto parts. I said, "Oh yeah, I can sing those." People talk about exercising for singing, and what do you do? Well, they say, anything you do to make your body, the instrument stronger, more supple, and everything, that's good. That's good. They don't advise a whole bunch of heavy weight training because it tends to tighten up your shoulders. It's supposed to have kind of really loose shoulders. So being fit helps singing. A lot of these singers are in super good shape. You see through these rock singers, they work out like crazy in the gym. Really do. They're athletes, actually. Powerful constitutions. I don't have that, but I got to try what I can do. So live the grand life. Live your life in a grand style in terms of good, really good habits. Why not? Why not? There's no reason why not. Treat yourself well. I'm not watching television. I'm not, paying attention. Not following any news. Not following any storylines in the world at all, actually. I'm following the storyline of transmissions that are happening right now. Spiritual transmissions. That's the storyline I'm following. What better storyline is there to follow than that? So I'm giving out the news here. This is like the real newscast every evening. You get this newscast of the real storyline in this world. And that is the coaches in the house, the transmission coaches in the house giving transmissions. And we have the ground. Jesus tilled the ground for us. Okay, he broke up all the stones in the ground. Okay, so we can so the tear so the seeds that he's sowing can rest on fertile ground and put roots down, right? The parable of the sower. Jesus is the one that broke all the rocks up, and now we have this fertile deep soil. Okay, where this beautiful plant can grow and bear the fruit. So here comes the fruit. Here comes the fruit. Longchamp is the one who goes around and, walks by the fruit tree, and the fruit's on the tree, but it's not quite ripe. It's he walks past, and what happens? The fruit ripens. It's like that. The fruit ripens. He's the fruit ripener. Longchamp is the fruit ripener. Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma is like the one that gives special fertilizer. Like, she comes in and says, right at this point in time, that the tree really needs this boost. I'm going to give some special fertilizer of mine that really get it to really all the flowers set right, the fruit grows faster. So she's fertilized it in a particular way occasionally, right? And Ram Maharshi is the beauty of the tree. It's the beauty of the tree and the beauty of the fruit. And you just like look at it, ah, what a beautiful tree. What beautiful fruit. What beautiful flowers. Wow. I can't wait till the fruit is ripe. Jesus prepared the soil, planted the tree, put the seed in the ground, planted the tree, helped us tend to it. But right now, the fruit's on the tree. And I'd say, come on, we need ripe fruit, ripe fruit, ripe fruit. Along comes Longchenpa, and he stands by the tree. He says, it's a nice tree, huh? And then he walks away, and next day you go look at the tree and say, oh my God, look, the fruit is ripening. It's ripening. It's ripe. I see a ripe fruit. Oh my gosh. What happened? This is amazing. This is a good way to look at it. You just imagine this beautiful tree in your garden. And it takes a lot to get that fruit ripe in this world, doesn't it? It really does. That's the story. The rest of the stuff is no story at all. As I said it, we've said crises are coming. Okay, that's all we need to say. Crises are coming, for sure. One way or another, right? One way or another, I'm going to get you. Crises are going to get the world. We've been experiencing kind of a little grace period, lull before the storm, and so we want to have access to super confidence. We want to have access to super confidence. This is our goal. One way or another, we want to have access to super confidence. We want to be in that. We want to be in that. We want to be in that super confidence. This tastes better on a hot day. Definitely does. Especially when you're hot and you're working out or whatever. A nice cold cavita tastes really good. So whatever your good habits are, just really keep them going right now and really emphasize them. And give yourself confidence saying, well, I could really do this. I'm really good at this. And it's just like the workout I was doing today. Oh, man, I'm just like, wow. Hopping and sidestepping and going backwards and just doing all this stuff. I haven't done that at all. It was in the last 8 months, you know, since I started. Suddenly, I went into this mode of doing all this movement, and it does make you tired. There's no question about it. I guess there's a reason why us adults don't do too much skipping, right? We skip the skipping because it's like, oh. Why shouldn't we be able to skip? Why shouldn't we be able to skip? Hopping along. And technically, I guess you do hop twice, little bunny hop on one leg, but I mean, do one more. If you really want to work out, do one more. That, or two more. That, and then to the next leg. That. Oh. Now, we may go back to like it was in the 60s or something with transmissions of some sort. I mean, I'm not a Shaktipat person, really. I don't really understand that, you know, the transmitting energy or some sort of force or something like that. The transmissions that I've experienced in a dream, there's no sense of energy at all. And the experience is just like totally smooth, as far as just, it's just like this gentle, the gentlest dawning, more gentle than any dawning you can imagine. That's, it's like that. It's more gentle than any dawning you can imagine. It's just, it's like that. And it's just, so you can't describe it. It's more gentle than you can, than it's indescribably what it is. It's indescribably what it is. But you might say it's the opposite of some sort of wow, hit by some energy fields. It's the absence of being hit by anything, really. It's the opposite of that. It's so. But as soon as you try to conceptualize it, you won't get it. You know, really. So you got to stay away from that. But anyway. But there could be some value to the stuff that happened in the 60s, Shaktipat, and various things like that. It is what you make of it. A lot of this stuff is what you make of it. What you get out of it, what you put into it. And I guess a lot of people, what they put into it wasn't so great. But some put a lot of, you know, something really good into it, and they got a lot of really great, super great help out of it. But it's possible. You know, we're headed towards something like that. Longchenpa could just walk by a crowd, just walk past people, and they would all get transmissions. Wouldn't have to say a word. He might smile and wave or something like that. But now the idea is that the Pope can do that. So they go to see the Pope, they think they're going to be blessed. In theory, one who is, you know, has the grace to do that, certainly they can do it. But, you know, is the Pope, is that doing that? Well, there's a lot of people that they want to feel something, and you know, if they get something, great. But the Pope is there because the cardinals decided that, you know, politically this is the way they wanted to go, and so they just elected this Pope, elected a cardinal, another cardinal Pope. He's not there because he has he's abiding in clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, and has absolute complete mastery of every aspect of approach and understanding of everything, and is just completely super confident with a 360 degree mind dissolved in the one life. He's not there because of that. So, it's apples and oranges. People's faith in the Pope can certainly give them some experience if the faith is sufficient. But it's still not quite the same. It's not quite the same, really. But a lot of people, hope for that. But I am sure that Longchenpa, just walking past anybody, just standing near anyone near him, they're going to get a transmission if that's what they want. You're not going to get it if you don't ask for it. But if you really ask for it, this is what you're going to get. So I had this prayer, I really prayed, and he showed up. And I said, if you can help at all, well, what was the help he gave me? Clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. That's it been extremely helpful. So that's what he's giving. He's giving out this clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, this vision of oneness, the one life, as Jesus says, the vision of Christ, the vision of oneness, vision, just the one life. Don't think about it. Whatever you do, don't think about it. Just wow it. This is the discipline we have here. As Jesus says, it's a journey beyond words. Just wow it. Be sure to wow it. Intellectuals have trouble with this because they say, well, I mean, what am I, stupid? I mean, I get it. I already got it. Now, what's the next question? They're so used to like doing tests fast because they often, these academics test, how fast can you get the answers? How fast can you get the answers? And a lot of the tests are timed. You say, my gosh, I gotta answer 50 questions. I gotta do it in half an hour or 20 minutes or whatever. Okay, A. B. Okay, boom. This is the way we train ourselves. This is a horrible training that we put ourselves through. Ghastly training. So they say, okay, I'm supposed to be seeing the wow. Okay, I'm in the wow. Okay, I got that one. Now, what's the next question? Now, what's the next step? What's the next question? I need to pass this test. I need to pass this test. That, of course, totally ruins it. Don't have a prayer when you have that attitude. It's the opposite of what you need, really. It's hideous. That's why I dropped out in about seventh grade. I stopped. I said, this is going to ruin my life. Our education really ruins our lives, actually. If you want to ruin your life, just get an education here in this world right now. It's abominable. Because the education you need is this full stop in the wow, the capacity to do this. Where you're not answering any questions and you're not on any timetable whatsoever. You're just immersed in the wow, you're just sitting here quietly, just patiently. And you're just focused. It's like you're balancing on a beam or something. You're just focusing on keeping your balance. That's all you're doing. Imagine if there's this beam on hydraulics that pushes the beam up, and so you're up high on the beam and you're balancing, and slowly the hydraulics are lowering the beam down to the ground, and so you don't know how long it's going to take, but you're just, all you care about, I'm just not going to fall, that's it. And ultimately, finally, the beam is finally back on the ground, and then you walk off the beam, you go, wow, okay, I did it, I did it, I'm back on solid ground again. It's kind of like that. And you don't know how long the hydraulics, how slow or fast they're going to go. Sometimes they go a little faster, then they slow down, go really slow hydraulics. So like a balance beam on two hydraulic tubes that push it up, like a car lift. You see, in garages, the car, the hydraulics push the car lift up. You're balancing on this metal beam, and it's like going down slowly. So you're just making sure you don't lose your balance. And actually doing balance and exercise, which I do, are very helpful on the spiritual path to give you this feeling like you're just really focused right in the now. Because if your mind starts to wander, you're going to fall off for sure. I use those foam exercise rollers. It's like about 6-inch one or something, and I just stand on it and I work on keeping my balance. And as soon as the mind starts straying, you know, because whoops, I for just a brief second I wasn't making the adjustment I needed to make. In order to keep your balance, you have to be very much aware where your weight's going and where you're, you know, going towards losing your balance, and then quick little correction, quick. Always very aware. It's a super great awareness training. And this, the wow is like that. It's like, I really got to just keep my balance right now. I'm not going to show off at all. If I start trying to do a dance on that beam, I'm going to fall. So you don't dance. You just try to be very still. Very still. Weight centered, you know. If you make, just do everything you can just to keep that balance. I was doing these squats last night, and you squat down and then count to 20, slowly to 20, and then up, and then down, count to 20. Wow, did that wipe me out? I did, I think, 5 of them. Because you're squatting down, all the way down, and you're having to keep your balance for 20 seconds, and you're having to make all these little adjustments to your body, and then push back up. Oh, that's a really great exercise. So these exercises do tie in with full stop in the wow. We do have exercises. I highly recommend that you do some exercises, some fitness, and balance is like a really, really important one. Really important. And skipping is gives you the sense of liberation. Like, I'm not really tied to duality anymore. I'm skipping and hopping along and twirling. Skipping, hopping, twirling along. Just, wow. Just like, you know, kids are just so happy and full of bursting with energy, how they don't just plod along, you know? They're skipping, hopping, and twirling and laughing and clapping their hands and dashing off here and dashing there. And then they come running back. They'll run in a funny way just because it's fun. They don't just kind of run like a real standard way. They'll run with their hands in the air. They'll do something that's just fun for them. I mean, why don't we do that? Walk a little quick miniature step like that. You see the kids, they're always having fun with as they're moving. They're always having fun with it. Why can't we do that? What happened where that became stupid? Well, we said, well, I got to grow up. I'm not a kid anymore. I'm working hard to grow up. I'm doing things the way the older folks do. Why? What the heck happened to that? Crazy, huh? And clapping, you know, they're skipping and clapping, maybe even singing a song as they're skipping along. Why can't we do that? Come on, what is wrong with us? When was the last time you saw someone's adult skipping along and clapping their hands and singing a song? I mean, I guess you go to concerts there, but everybody, you know, says, well, I was just completely wiped out on drugs and alcohol and whatever, you know, it's like, yeah, I got kind of crazy, you know, shaking my hands or, you know, raving or something. But, I mean, what is that? I mean, just go along a nice little dirt trail and just be snapping your fingers and twirling and hopping and just singing, you know, and just it puts you in a completely different mindset, actually. It's super liberating. No, but the adults, I gotta, you know, hike 10 miles a day up this heavy road, you know, heavy trail, and get my trail poles here. And, oh, I made it, you know. I was like, yeah, gotta really show I'm a big, strong adult and I can do this all stuff. But it'd be better to do like 5 minutes of hopping and skipping and twirling and vaulting and clapping and snapping the fingers and singing and, yeah. I mean, don't you think Jesus? I mean, Jesus say, "Okay, apostles, get in line with me. Okay, we're gonna walk like this. You know, very purposeful, very serious." Now, Jesus might be like, kind of like skipping along, smiling and skipping, clapping. You know, me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. Me and Jesus, we got it all worked out. You know? Yeah, me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. We don't need anybody to tell us what it's all about. But you don't. People think you're crazy. You're on drugs or something. Now, the hippie movement was trying to get people to do that kind of loosen up, oh, people. I mean, what had happened? Because we were so corporate, buttoned down in the 50s and 60s, early 60s. So the hippies were just, I mean, you know, I love the hippies. You know, the way that it all spun out, you know, is of course the world, you know, really tried to sabotage it, and the ego self-sabotages ourselves, and the drugs came in, and you know, it got, you know, so okay, that happened. But the mood of the hippies, you know, the flute, da 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 da. I'm going to the country, baby, you wanna go? I'm going to the country, baby, you wanna go? We're going someplace where we've never been before. Do 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 do, yeah, da 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 da. And it's just like hippies are like just they're like children. They acted like children. It was like adults acting like children. You know, the drugs came in and ruined it. Yeah, I hate drugs. They ruin stuff. They really ruin it. You don't need drugs. It's just that people are using drugs to try to get free of their inhibitions. And the hippies said, hey, man, whatever it takes. You know, I mean, there was a lot of stuff involved with the drugs. CIA, all sorts of MK Ultra, you know, the whole ball of wax, all the alphabet stuff, alphabet agencies, and you know, whatever, it just, you know, so it got too heavy. You don't need a drug. You don't need drugs. The people thought they needed them. They need to get drunk to just kind of like let loose because they're so uptight. But that's not the way. That's not the way. That's a very stupid way to do it. Stupid way to go about it. It's proven. Look at the backlash and where we're at now. You don't see anybody doing that hardly. It'd be less people taking ecstasy, taking drugs, and just raving. You know, got some, you know, DJ something, DJ rave, and just putting all this electronic, boom, 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 you know, music, and people like gyrating like, you know, like robots or something, like, you know, I'm robotic, but I'm getting loose or something. Oh, come on, you know, come on, come on. And kids are not sensual. They're joyous. They're joyous. They're delight. They're delighted. They're delighted. Ah, this delight isn't delighted. So the way they move, you know, it's just. Ah, oh, look at that tree. Hello, tree. Wow. Look at that tree. Ooh, it's a big tree. And you know, they use their body in all sorts of ways, unself-conscious ways. So people were trying to get unself-conscious, conscious. You know, these IBM, you know, button-down guys go out on the weekend and drink a little wine and listen to, Janis Joplin or something, Monterey Pop, and try to, move and give me another slug of wine. Man, I mean, just, I've been at a desk for 20 years, it's like, maybe if I grow my hair long and shake it, shake it, put on a leather fringe coat with all the tassels, shake the tassels and then try to get loose. I'm trying to loosen up, man. Wow. So we've been down that road and we look at it and we say, wow, okay, a lot of very good facets to it. And we're at another uptight time in history right now. Totally uptight. Like I said, the techies, I mean, wow. I saw a techie trying to exercise. I said that's a sight to behold. And so we're right back where we started, kind of like, I mean, you could have a hippie revolution in the Silicon Valley and it would just go nuts. Larry Ellison would be hosting it on Mountain Home Road. And everybody would be walking around, doing Zazen stuff or what, I don't know, but it absolutely could happen here now. It could happen again. It absolutely could happen again. But of course, the drugs will come into it and all the junk will come into it. It should be like some like inner circle thing, like fencing out around it, and then all the people on drugs, they have to stay outside the fence. They can audit it, they can audit it, but no, you can't come into the real party if you're on any drugs at all. Because you have to, it's all about being in touch with your compassion and wowing the whole situation. Consciously, soberly wowing it. And when the wow comes, you just stop and you just sit down. Ah. The 60s were awesome, Ram Dass there on the New York estate and everybody's just wowing out, and playing music and just walking and they'll just stop and just, so they were getting the flavor of it, so at least they tried, so, 10,000 cheers for the hippies. At least they tried. It's better to have loved and lost than never loved at all, right? So at least they tried to love. At least they tried to the one mind. They tried, I guess they felt they were so incompetent at, they had to use drugs. This is pretty much what the trouble was. They felt very insecure, very incompetent. And they felt, we needed a crutch, we got to take drugs. But right now, we don't feel insecure or incompetent at all. Not at all. So we have this huge advantage. Now, it's different. It's different. There'll still be, there's a lot of people who do feel very insecure about spiritual truth. Not here. Not here. But the hippies got it going. Maybe we can now help finish the deal, ripen the fruit. I hope so. I hope a lot of those hippies see the day where some fruit is ripened. They said, look, drop out. Get away from your desk, get away from the computers. Go listen to a flute. Go listen to Shiva's flute or Krishna's flute and just sit there. And just look at the tree. Talk to the tree if you want to. Go up and pat the tree. It's a high tree. You're the one life too. There's just this one life. And draw a mandala in the dust. And you put some stones and make a beautiful mandala. Why not? And when the wow comes upon you, just sit there and don't do anything. It's okay. So God bless all the hippies and all those who have pushed it along, and even though they had insecurities, they still tried. So that deserves major kudos, actually. And they, it ran out of steam. It ran out of steam, but it didn't entirely disappear. Never disappeared in me. I said, we have to get to the fruit of this here. Let's not get lost, as it goes corporate and all the corporations gobble it up and regurgitate it back to us and give us. Speaking of corporations, I really had a massive clarification today. I got a handle I got a handle on everything actually right now. That's how I feel. I feel so super confident. I have a handle on everything, so I can choose what I want to talk about. I don't have to talk about this or that because I got a handle on politics right now. Really got a total handle on it. I know exactly what's going on. So. Yeah, I don't have to talk about it. I'm not insecure, so oh yeah, I got to talk about politics. No, I could pick it up by the handle anytime I want to, or set it down. So I'd rather talk about the hippies right now. You talk about someone who could play some music that you want to for the what do you want to call this, the age of transmission or something, that this is we're now in the age of transmission. Bradford so Solan Brad Solan, his music on YouTube, this stuff is just great. His music, this just puts you in the mood of confidence and wow. It's not all wild and frenetic. It's not trying to get you out from behind your desk. It's like it puts more trust in you. It says you're already out from your desk, you've already done that. I mean, it's a very trusting music. It trusts. You can feel the trust in it, trusting our spirit. It really. This is where it's at. I say trust it. This is our motto. Trust it. This is shorthand. Twilight language, trust it. And you just hear that, you just get it. Oh yeah, trust it. That's what Ramana says. I got it from Ramana. Trust it. It's like, wow, it's just like totally profound. It just says it all, doesn't it? That's Ram Maharshi right there. Just trust it. And you look at him and say, okay, I'll trust it. So Brad Solan's music, along with his, I think his brother and someone else is involved, perhaps his wife or someone. There's just a few people, but good Lord, the music's beautiful, and it's all about, you feel the trust there. You feel the trust. The music trusts us, right? That's what we're getting to. Okay, that's where we're at now, is we're trusting it now. We're trusting ourselves now. And I sent him a little note, and he sent me one, a really nice one back. And he says, if you're ever in Tucson, absolutely get in touch. And maybe I can hear him play, and feel that trust, that music. But it's on YouTube right now, and it's great. It's great. It's different. It's different. We're not used to hearing music that really trusts us. Trust us spiritually. Like, we trust ourselves spiritually. So we got a whole world full of people that are just spending their whole lives, doing coding behind desks and just every, they're just in these little cubicles, and I went into this cubicle today. These folks who spend all their day on desks doing papers and, you know, invoices and writing business stuff. And there's a lady there. She's so overweight. She's a very nice lady. They're talking with me, the guy and this lady, and about their business. And I must have looked like an alien to them. You know, someone came from another planet. Because I just breezed in, and I'm like, you know, I'm just like on fire of this super, super certainty. Super certainty. But they just love talking with me. They just ask me all sorts of questions. And I kind of like just sort of twirled in there like a like a beautiful whirlwind of leaves or something. They're kind of looking at me like, wow, we kind of like talking with him. I said, okay, gotta go, folks. Have a beautiful rest of your day. Don't just have a nice day. Say, have a beautiful rest of your day. Or have a just a wonderful rest of your day. You know, just, you know, don't just, hello, how are you? Have a nice day. I wrote this song once. At least I was planning to. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. And this is the world. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. And you put this ching, you know, castrator ching, 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 ching to it. And it's just like this robotic thing. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. And because this, would you go up to the castrator, isn't that what happens? You know, say, hello, how are you? And then doing the money to slide the chip. I said, got a chip on up. Okay. Okay. Have a nice day. Next one. Hello. How are you? And then, okay. Have a nice day. So it's hello. How are you? Have a nice day. Hey. Hello. How are you? Have a nice day. Hey. Yeah. That would have been a great song. I can write songs. I proved it to myself. I can write a song, 2-3 songs a day. Just pow, 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 pow. If I really get into it, I can do it. I've done it. But, you know, what's the use? Unless you got Brad Soland doing your song. he knows how to do a song, you know? It's a genius. I can't explain it. He knows how to do a song because he's trusting it. That's the genius. That's the spirit. That comes from compassion. He's trusting his compassion. So any lyrics, I mean, you know, it's going to work. It will work. It will work. So don't say just have a nice day. Just have a tremendous rest of your day, really. They're kind of like, people kind of look at it like, oh, yeah, you too. And you could say, you know what? If someone says to you, say, you know what? I'm gonna let that happen for me. I'm gonna let that happen for me, and you let it happen for you too, or something like that. Gotta get away from this you too thing. You know, like, oh, you too. What, you dualistically? So. Back in the 60s, you know, peace. I mean, we didn't really say namaste. That's a little bit of affectation into today's world. It's going to come trite, but you would say, hey, peace, man. You know, peace and love. You know, really, but we meant it. So we say goodbye, or, you know, since they have a nice day, we just say, peace, peace, love, peace, understanding. Have a blessed day. And said, have a blessed day as well. Have a blessed day as well. All blessings to you. You have to say you too. Say all blessings upon you. All blessings upon you. Yeah, may all blessings be upon you for the rest of the day. May the rest of your day be absolutely wonderful. So if someone says, have a nice day, just say, may the rest of your day be absolutely wonderful. And then walk away. Don't say, oh, you too. You too. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. You too. Hello, how are you? Have a nice day. You too. Hello, how are you? That doesn't really work, but have a robotic day. Have a absolutely wonderful day. Someone has that almost for a day. May your day be wonderful as well. Okay, so have a really nice day. May your day be wonderful as well. Yeah, may your day be really wonderful as well. So there's a little more, see, there's compassionate. It's not robotic. We're becoming extremely robotic, this world, if you really are hip to it. Extremely robotic. This is, again, a disaster. I don't think the hippies can pull our fat out of the fire right now. You're going to need the Dilang Champa to start transmitting to pull our fat out of this fire. By the way, I left the pulp in the smoothie last night. I said, heck with it, it's too much work. I'm just going to leave it in. That's fine. I can do it. Just drink it. So I got two more packages of kale today. But I don't think I'm going to do half a package. I'm going to like do a third a package. I mean, hey, it's not bad at all, really. You just have to get past the horror of it all. The green slime is going down. What is this? It's just kale. It's just pulverized kale. Mix it with cranberry juice. Cranberry juice is a good mixer for pretty much anything, and just drink it on down and feel like, you know what, this is going to help me skip tomorrow. You can say, have a real skippy day, and says, you know what, I will, and you have a skippy day as well. Peace, love, namaste, om paranirvana. You could just say om paranirvana to someone. I say paranirvana. Okay, because it's beyond attainment and non-attainment. As Longchamp says, it's beyond samsara and nirvana. It's not really beyond it. It's that there's just the one life. And so samsara and nirvana are, and he explains it, you know, I'll let him, his words are basically perfect. The way he keeps coming at it from so many angles, and it's just, it's all coming at this, just the very same, just one life, you know, one life. You know, you had George Harrison, the beautiful, wonderful George Harrison. Loved George Harrison. You don't need a love nest. You don't need an assignation. You don't need a horoscope or a microscope to see the mess that you're in. If you open up your heart, you know what I mean. Been down so long. Here's a way to get free. Try chanting the name of the Lord and you'll be free. Chanting the name of the Lord and you'll be free. Because the Lord is awaiting on you all to come and see. All Things Must Pass album, produced by Phil Spector, believe it or not. I believe. Well, sound. Well, the Lord is awaiting yon all to awaken and see. That's it, to awaken and see. And the Lord is awaiting for you all to awaken and see. However, Longchamp would make one slight little alteration. You never went to sleep. So the Lord is awaiting for you to recognize and see that you never went to sleep, but you only pretended to be. Da 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 da. So hippies don't worry about doing it right. It's about the attitude. It's the attitude. But they're not intentionally trying to have a scruffy attitude at all. No, not at all. When they feel like, when they're able to do something beautiful, they do. And if they're tired, it's understandable. Well, you know, my voice is tired. So, and I need to speak quietly. So it's all good. It's all coming from the heart of compassion. And this is what the hippies were tuned into. And, you know, it scattered to the four winds, and You got the Earth Mother worshippers, the pagan cults came in, and all this kind of stuff. But the genuine hippies, wow, you know, you'd be hard pressed to meet anyone more beautiful than that. Come along in their VW van. Hey brother, hey sister, you need a ride? Sure, come on in, man. Come on in. They got some beautiful music. You maybe have some Ravi Shankar and the sitar and the music and on their tape deck or something. I don't know if they had tape decks back then. But probably not. The cassette deck didn't come out yet, did they? So I don't know what they do. Maybe they'd have a record player somehow. I don't know. They have a generator plugged in, record player. They'd figure it out. Hippies would figure it out. They're craftsmen. They're good at it. Or they'd just be singing. They'd be going down the road, but just singing. Someone would be the guitar, who's the guitar. They're singing folk songs or something. And they'd be like tossing flowers out the windows as they go along. You know, that someone like picked a bunch of flowers from a yard somewhere, and so they'd have thousands of flowers, and you're going down the road, and you're singing songs, and just throwing slowly, going down the road slowly, maybe 30 miles, 35 miles an hour, or whatever, just tossing flowers up and just watching them go, you know, float in the wind. And not on drugs. You don't need drugs to toss flowers out of windows, do you? And if they saw something they didn't they like, they just stop. Get out, side of the road, take a look at this. Wow, this is beautiful. Look at this beautiful tree. They just pull over by the tree, get out. And maybe they'd start clapping and singing a song to the tree just because they just felt this is just the one life. This is just an aspect. This is the one life expressing itself through ornamentation. And it's just beautiful. And they allowed time for the beautiful like this. And maybe they do a mandala around the tree with flower blossoms. Okay. But they kept on moving, they kept on grooving, they didn't get fixated on it, didn't turn into a cult, a mother goddess cult, a, you know, nature goddess cult or something. No, they said, you know, let the wind take the flowers away, it's all beautiful, it's all just ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. This is where, you know, it was coming from, at its root. And so it's still here, there's still, you know, we went underground, basically, I went underground. I was hip to it. I was hip to it. I was a little young, but things got kind of messed up by 1969. It got, you know, that was pretty much the end of it. But of course, I was the guy playing the guitar because I was, you know, super musical and I could play the heck out of an acoustic guitar back then. I could, you know, play all day. But it was pretty mild. I mean, we, you know, a lot of that stuff came from New York. A lot of the artsy stuff came from New York, the Woodstock generation. Those people are very self-reliant. We were not that self-reliant, just got a kid grew up in the suburbs. But those very self-reliant hippies, they just get in the bus and drive across country, and their parents weren't worried about them because they trusted these guys, you know, these guys and gals could take care of themselves. They were smart. They were... from generations of very independent, self-reliant folks. And so, sure, they just travel around with their guitar and just see the USA. I mean, wow, what a beautiful life. All kudos to them. And they're in no hurry. You know, no job, no this, but somehow they found a way to get from one place to the next place. Just imagine how far we've gone from that, actually. And they just stop by a side road and camp at nighttime, just like my dad did. We used to do that. You go to Colorado, you just stop and just camp on the side of the road. Didn't go to hotels or motels or anything. Just had sleeping bags, just rolled them out. It's been a long time since I've seen a hippie like that. That is for sure. I see him now working in stores and stuff, and I kind of say, hey, you know, hear a song and sing. And they say, oh, were you there? Yeah, I was there. I said, yeah, wow, Miss those days. No kidding. People just hitchhike where, you know, hippies, you see their hippies, stop and pick them up. There's no questions asked. You know, hey, welcome aboard. Welcome aboard the good ship, Intrinsic Spaciousness. But then technology started coming to the thing, and people start, you know, grooving on a pyramid culture, you know, and all this. Yeah, we can really find that, what we're looking for through technology, and how are we doing with that now? What they really said, we can make trillions of dollars on technology if we just decide to monitor everybody. Just imagine how many monitoring devices. There'll be trillions of monitoring devices in the world, actually. And every one of those is money going into our pockets. So we can build a, you know, 5-acre lake and a Zazen garden in our estate on Mountain Home Road. And, you know, we can do that and have a little, our little samurai fiefdom replica of some Kyoto temple. Ah, the hippies didn't need that. The hippies could see intrinsic spaciousness in anything. I mean, this is where the vibe was coming from. And you might just see a hippie just sitting somewhere, and they're totally quiet. Now, before all the drugs showed up, you didn't say, well, they're on drugs. And I think that they're communing with nature. A lot of the movement picked up a lot of stuff from the American Indians. And the Indians would sit quietly communing with the Great Spirit. And so a lot of hippies would just do that. They just sit quiet. If they felt the vibe was right, they just sit quietly in the wow of it. But they lacked the closer confidence, okay? They were amateurs, but there's nothing wrong with being amateurs. It's like a baseball player, or a golfer. They're like amateur golfers. That's great. It's great for the game. But so at some point, you know, the pros got to step in and say, this is how you really do it. This is how you really do it. And at some point, you got to go from being an amateur to being a pro, a real pro at it. And this is what I've been working on. I realized, you know, that this is only going to go so far, and it did only go so far. And from that point, you got to cross this gap between being an amateur and a pro. Longchenpa's a pro, by the way. He's a pro's pro. And if you're a pro, you know what he's about. You get it. But look, the hippies are part of our spiritual culture, big time. The beatniks, the hippies, you know, the whole thing, they're part of our spiritual culture here, as are the American Indians, actually, in the United States. Very much part of our spiritual culture here. And the American Indians were, some of them were pros, actually. You might be able to say that. They had some know-how, and they just called it the Great Spirit. The Great Spirit. This is all the body of the Great Spirit. It's all just one life. I think that we may have romanticized them a little bit here. That happens when you're desperate for some authority. You might romanticize them to a certain extent. I wouldn't go so far as to call them Dharma kings, shamans maybe. You know, they had some they had shamanistic knowledge, you might say, but they had a lot of. Anyway, it's part of the spiritual culture that's transmitted through, and so we absolutely respect that here in the West. We do have this, but we needed some infusion infusion from the real pros, and we've been getting that. But don't, you know, don't discount the, like the New Yorkers, you know, the hip Woodstock generation. I mean, that place back east, those people have a lot of what it takes. Very impressive, actually. Come from some really good stock back there. Very creative, very confident in certain ways. And so they've tried to bring some of that, you know, the proness into the scene. They have been helpful in that. There's a cross-fertilization between the West Coast and the East Coast in the Midwest, and there's cross-fertilization that's taken place. There's some advantages to being out here, too, on the West Coast. We tend to be more of a explorer culture, you know, the people who came out West. We're really... We have this sort of burning desire to journey and make a journey and find what we're looking for, and we're very, very intent on you know, getting it. You see all these homes out here; it's ridiculous. The people, I mean, they just want to build their paradise here. Really, they're very intent on finding paradise out here. That's why they come to California. They think they can find paradise here. So, you know, that's driving them here. Certainly is driven me. You know, I've got to find paradise. Come on. Because, you know, there's nowhere else to go. You got the ocean right there. You say, wow, you know, there's no more land. I this is it. So I got to find it. I have to say this: the U.S. is pretty screwed up right now, and I'm finding that the best, you know, feedback that I've gotten on this site comes from those from other countries. Right? We have someone from Spain, someone from Romania, someone from Israel, you know, various places. A lot of it comes from different countries of the world, who are maybe not as screwed up as the United States. The United States is really, really screwed up right now. And people, they're stuck. They're really stuck because of this whole horrible polarization here. And basically, you know, the attempt to get rid of the Christian conservatives to wipe them out here, just like they wipe the Indians out. Because they're standing in a way of global corporatism, which is really communism. I mean, communism is just the control of the world by corporations, actually. Because they just use the media to propagandize you, and they want you to be just a sheep, a consumer sheep. That's it. They want to just dictate to you what your preferences, what your wants are, and you do exactly as they tell you to do. So the political party of the Politburo is just a front for these massive corporations, internet, global corporations, actually. And they want, again, to have this global dictatorship of the corporations. And the media is just their lying propagandists. And so what's standing in the way of that right now? It's the conservative right in America. That's what's standing in the way. So they absolutely hate them and want to destroy them. And the media is just, everyone's trying, to, you know, the media is trying their best to absolutely crush them. And so there's this huge polarization here. It is a vicious, it's a civil war that's taking place in America actually right now. You know, it's a fact. People say that they're afraid a civil war is going to happen. No, there's already a civil war here. It's been going on for quite some time. And the people are just so busted up about this and so that nobody can really just get into that hippie mode, you know, intrinsic spaciousness mode. They say, no, first we got to deal with this. You know, we've got this really bad trouble. So I really feel people in other countries, they're so much more relaxed. They can get into this non-dual vibe, this non-dual groove. We're just not getting into it here. This is astonishing. I said, what happened to the United States hippies? Maybe they have moved to different countries now. Maybe they're living in Goa or something. I don't know. But, or Kathmandu or whatever. But here, wow. It's the people cannot focus on compassion anymore. And the answer to the situation is simply pragmatism. That's all. Just alternate. You know, give 8 years to the liberals, 8 years to the conservatives, because both sides want to wipe out the other, pretty much. I wouldn't quite say it about the conservatives, but, you know, they both hate each other. They both fear each other. And you give, you know, too many years, 16 years to the liberals, and they will crush them. They will wipe out. They'll put them on reservations, same way that happened to the Indians. So you just pragmatically just have to alternate. You know, you don't have to pick sides. You just give 8 years to the conservatives, 8 years to the liberals, and, you know, keep everyone alive that way. And each one can kind of undo the terrible mistakes of the previous 8 years. And yeah, we kind of, you know, you don't get any resolution to it, but to resolve it, you could get one side wiped out. Just like this, you know, the North won the Civil War. It was terrible for the South, and they've never recovered. You know, Sherman, look what Sherman did. Sherman's in March to the Sea for Plan H. He destroyed everything in his path. I mean, you know, he was like ISIS, Sherman, you know? It's terrible. They took, you know, terrible retribution on the South. So you can't have one side or the other dominating here in America. In order for a democracy to work, you have to put up with this. Okay, now they're in power, and then later on, okay, we're in power. Okay, now they're back in power. You can't have this dictatorship of one party, because that's exactly what the corporations want. It's exactly what they want. They want the liberals to dominate and crush the conservative right, religious conservative right. Because they're standing in the way of global corporate dictatorship, which is really a communistic system, very much so. So I'm not getting hardly anything from the United States. I mean, you know, there's just a few, and they're struggling. But other than that, I have not gotten any responses from the United States. It's just extraordinary. It is just unbelievable, actually. It is totally unbelievable. I've got a little space left here on this disc here. So thank you for those around the world who are commenting and watching the videos. Thank you very much. We appreciate it. All Americans appreciate it very much, because at least you're keeping the compassion alive. You're in touch with your compassion, because we are not right now. We are not. We're just, people have turned into political animals. Nobody's talking. Everybody's afraid to talk. Well, what side are you on? I don't know if you're on my side or if you're on their side. Paranoid. Political correctness has paralyzed us. It's like a tick. Got bit by a tick. And got some weird tick disease that's paralyzing us. I don't know what to do about it. I've tried everything I can. I've tried for so long. To build a bridge to help us, you know, to get over this situation. Just be pragmatic. That's the answer. I got to handle it. You just got to be here. You got to live with it. In democracy, you got to live with it. Guess what? The other side gets to be in power now. That's it. That's pretty right. Okay, boo hoo. Well, you know, 8 years later, you'll get to be in power. Kind of, it'll shift over. Yeah, but we can't really reach our objectives. Well, good, because your objectives is to dominate, and that's not democracy. Democracy is free enterprise system is a messy system, but the alternative is corporate dictatorship. Corporations would love to smash the free enterprise system, destroy it. They're greedy. They want to dominate. They don't want someone come along. Look at the gas companies. Do you think the gas companies want someone come along with something that makes gasoline obsolete or, no. They want to so dominate that anybody who comes up with an invention that will, put them out of business, they want to destroy them. But the idea of the free enterprise system is, it's sure it's vulnerable because somebody else may come with a better idea, build a better mousetrap. Whoops. So it's not for the weak of heart. It's for only for the brave. The industrious and the brave. Free enterprise system, democracy, and a free enterprise system. It's very tough. Most people are too lazy for it. They say, just give me a communist dictatorship, and I'll be happy. I'm tired of this stuff. So we're tired here of all this wrangling on politics. We're tired of it, really tired of it. And a lot of people here, they just want a dictatorship. So just turn it over to the liberals, let them be one party, completely dominate, and let the media just be these absolute liars, which they already are, and nobody have any check on them at all. And we'll all just live in this, communistic utopia, corporate utopia, so to speak. It will all just be, you already look at people schlepping their way to Target or something, and you look at it and you say, wait a minute. I mean, these people look like zombies. We're just consumer zombies. They want to turn us all into consumer zombies. They really do. This is not an exaggeration. I mean, if you ran a business, you'd probably want to also be able to control the buying habits and the tastes of everybody, so you can plan well for the next 100 years. I know exactly what they're going to buy, how much they're going to buy. I know exactly how to plan, how to order supplies, raw materials, and how much machinery I need to transform the raw material into products. Just the whole thing. You can plan it all out beautifully, and then just go play golf in your country club. And that's what they want. They don't want markets to go this way and that way. They want it just to be easy and smooth for themselves, which means controlling you, turning you into a zombie. But we don't really want that. We don't want to be zombies, because what happens is, how can you be a hippie if you're a zombie? How can you just throw flowers out the window and skip down and skip and twirl down a path and say hello to a tree and just look at the sky and say, wow, that's like the nature of the mind is sky-like. And just sit down or lie down in a field and just lay there for half an hour because you're so wowed out. How can you do that if you're a consumer zombie? No, you're going home watching the television because they're informing you of what you need to know. It's the religion of corporate global corporatism is television and movies. They'll keep you entertained, bread and circuses. So it's hideous here. It's really hideous. Be glad you're living somewhere else. Hopefully it's not as bad. Consumer paradise is actually hell. You don't need things to see intrinsic spaciousness. You can just see it in a rock, anywhere, everything. The wind, even a cloud, it's all just the one life. Creative display. It's just the creative display of the one life. And let the transmissions just happen, and you'll get it more and more and more and more. Don't worry about answers or questions. If you have transmission, you don't need that stuff. You just accept the transmission, and you just say, wow, I love this. I tried to keep the hippie thing going. I drive around California with my guitar and I just go places, sit on rocks, sit on a field, sit by a tree and play a song. And there's wildflowers blooming on mom and papa's grave. There are no tame ones ever brought here anymore. You go out in the wildflowers of California and just, sing a song. For the family, they've all gone. I've been in prison much too long. But God keeps the wildflowers blooming on mom and papa's grave. Woo, woo, woo. Yeah, I have a video of me doing that. I actually took a video once of myself doing that. Just way out in the Central California, up in the mountains, beautiful rock overlooking these beautiful valleys with wildflowers. I was just singing the song and just, you know, hammering it. It was just great. But nobody else is doing it. I didn't see anybody doing that. I drove the breadth and width of California all over. I didn't see any hippies. I didn't see anyone doing it. It completely disappeared. I said, wow, this is crazy. How could anything that had such super positive roots just dry up and disappear unless it's water in a desert? And what's the desert? Corporate materialism. Humanism. Humanistic corporate materialism. It's a desert. It's a desolate desert. All the water just sinks into the sand. It's gone. You're looking for the oases then, right? Where's the oasis? Oh, there's a pool of water there and some palm trees. Wow, let's play guitar by the palm trees. I always used to have acoustic guitars with me, classical acoustic guitars, electric guitars, whatever. I took them wherever I went and would play them by trees, by palm trees, wherever, just play songs, but nobody picked up on it. They wouldn't do it. They said, "Nah, hippie's dead. The death of the hippie. They buried the hippie." No, the hippie never died. Intrinsic spaciousness never dies. We're just pro hippies now. We're not amateurs anymore. We're pros. Whole different thing. Whole different ball game. We don't need the long hair. That's why I cut my hair. Don't need the long hair anymore. We're professional hippies now, real pros. Don't need the ragged clothes even. Don't need the dime store or the thrift shop clothes either. Don't need all the embroidery, you know. Don't need this stuff. Don't really need the bare feet either. We're professional. We're pros now, really professional at it, because we understand, you know, what the point of it all is, what the goal of it all is, and we know how to reach that goal now. So we're not just like on a long, strange trip, you know, tripping with the Grateful Dead. And no, we know what the goal is and how to get there, and we're getting there, and the fruit is ripening now. So it's a different story now. That doesn't mean you can't play a guitar in an oasis. No. If you really trust it, but you have to really trust it. Hippies are aged now. Baby boomers, right? They're over 60. Starting to go into rest homes. So. Maybe a lot of them are reincarnations of American Indians, actually. It's very possible. They want to try to get America, try to get the land back in the right hands, you know. Really. There's a bug. What's that bug? A lot of bugs flying around here. Summer nights. When you're cheerleading for Longchenpa, you're a pro. You know, he doesn't have amateurs on the sideline. He's got pros on the sideline. Yeah, we've paid our dues, I'll tell you that. I certainly have paid my dues. Longchenpa did another miracle today. He's responding in extraordinary ways. I'm not going to say what it was, but it was really profound. Wow. I asked him to help out with a situation. He helped out. It was quite astonishing. It was quite astonishing. I was just, wow. So ask the transmission guru to help out. They will. There's no limit. It's like Longchenpa is not like Santa Claus, where he's got a bag full of toys. Oh, whoops, I'm running out. I gave them some of this, and gave them some of this, and them some of that. But I don't want to give you too much. I already gave you one. You know, what about them over there? I got to throw something down their chimney, too. He hasn't run out. Reality is never exhausted or depleted in the slightest bit. Take everything away from me, and I just manifest it all again and again and again. It's never depleted at all. It only gets richer and richer and richer. So there's no quota from Longchenpa about transmissions. The more transmissions he does, the more that are coming. It gets better and better. So he's like, give him a workout. Come on. What are his workouts? Giving transmissions. So help Longchenpa do his workout. You know, he's just like sitting here saying, man, I'm really out of shape. You're not asking me for any transmissions. I came across someone else last night who had a vision of Longchenpa. Kenpo Shenga, who I believe saw Patrul Rinpoche, who was, a student of Jigme Lingpa, who had three empowerments from Longchenpa and created the Nying Thich, Longchenpa's Nyan Thich, which is the Dzogchen teachings that are pretty much in use, has been in use since, was it the 18th century or something like that? Jigme Lingpa had at least three powerful transmissions from Longchenpa, where his wisdom mind, he transmitted his wisdom mind to him, and you know, the ability of speech and all these great empowerments, and so then it was able to bring about this clear teaching of Dzogchen, which has been in use now for several hundred years, I think. And he had students, and one of them, I think, was maybe it was the Wang Po was in there somewhere, but Patrul Rinpoche, and then Kenpo Shenga, I believe that's his name, had a profound vision of Longchenpa. And then Kenpo Shenga was with Jamyang Kenshi Choki Lodo, who written in his book, in his autobiography, which only parts of it apparently have been read by some, he spoke of 17 visions of Longchenpa, profound visions. And that people say there may have been innumerable other ones that they haven't yet, you know, read about or something. He only wrote just a portion of his life. 17 different times Longchenpa appeared, gave tremendous transmissions to him. And this is someone in the 20th century. And then, of course, Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche was a student of Jamyang Khyentse Lodro, and Dilgo was the 20th century master, is like the heart of Dzogchen in the 20th century. D-I-L-G-O, Dilgo Khyentse Rinpoche. So you have this entire, you know, Dzogchen, Vajrayana Buddhism, Dzogchen lineages going back to Jigme Lingpa, who Longchenpa empowered And these teachers have had visions and empowerments from the Longchenpa. So Longchenpa has been in transmitting it for like a couple hundred years, recently, very, very profoundly, as he said he would. He was going to take care of business here. He wasn't going to leave us. He says, "You call on me, and I'll show up." And those who have called on him with compassion, he has showed up. So this is an extraordinarily historic fact that is, just extremely important. We have this transmission Dharma King who promised to show up and empower us here, and he has been doing that. Up to this point through Tibetan Buddhism, but now he's giving me transmissions and empowerments, and I'm not even a Tibetan Buddhist. I'm just ripe for it is all. He doesn't care, what label, how you label the fruit. It's either you're ripe for, if you're ripe for it, you're ripe for it. You ask for help, he gives you the help. He's willing to empower anyone, presumably, right? He'll empower the Westerners for sure. I have not felt a shred of trouble from him in that regard. It's a non-issue. For him, entire total non-issue. He transcends attainment and non-attainment, absolutely. You want a transmission? Longchenpa is your guy. What kind of transmission? Intrinsic spaciousness, vision of oneness, vision of one life. That kind of transmission. And if you want help, he'll give you help. I've got some stuff I need to help me with, actually. I'm going to have to ask him for help. I'm going to have to. I love to. A great opportunity for him. He's like, good, more the better, I got to get in shape here. Come on. You guys are not asking me for enough here. Ask more. I want to be skipping and a hopping and a twirling and a vaulting and a clapping and a snapping. And come on. Give me the requests. Request, please, 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 please. Let me help you. That's compassion. That's the heart of compassion. Let me help you. He's saving lives, actually, already. He's done extraordinary miracles already for me. When I've asked him to help out with some very, very nasty situations, they've resolved in beautiful ways. Taking into account the karma involved and all that kind of stuff. But he's brought him through. Brought him through. This is Guru Yoga. Call upon your transmission guru for help. And they will help. This is a fact throughout history. How do you think all this faith keeps going in the world? Because people have been helped. That's why. Christianity has lived on miracles for thousands of years. So many people receive miracles from Jesus and the apostles. People they so many people got miracles that they kept it alive, of course. They said, "Look, I don't need to believe it, and I know it's true. It works for me. This is true guru yoga." And that's the highest, most profound practice of all, the most effective at all is you literally, you do get the help, you do ask. So keep your life, keep asking and keep thanking and keep experiencing the miracles in your life. You can do it just from the Holy Spirit if you want to. A lot of people feel they'd rather they feel more comfortable asking someone who they know have been through the fires here in this world and really understand the struggles we have. So, having someone like Longchenpa who lived here in this world for 56 years, went through a lot of struggle and difficulty and all the political incorrectness that the people were after him and just the whole political stuff and the nonsense of this world and all the, everything. He went through it all. And so we know he understands it and doesn't, condemn us for it or judge us in any way. I get the feeling, he understands the difficulty because he wasn't really appreciated very much in his lifetime, actually. So And even to this day, you know, nobody hardly outside of high traditions of, you know, Vajrayana and Dzogchen, most people don't even know who he is. So he's like St. Jude, you know. He wasn't really, there's another great helper. They won't really appreciate it, but they have tremendous capability. So if we feel underappreciated, believe me, Longchenpa certainly understands that. He'll say, well, I don't underappreciate you. I'll tell you that. You can bet he appreciates every single one of us, knowing what it's like to be not appreciated. Same with St. Jude. He knows what it's like to be very unappreciated, in fact, scorned for a long time. 1,000 years or something, a long time. St. Jude was persona non grata because they confused him with Judas Iscariot. And so St. Jude knows what it's like to not be appreciated. So St. Jude very much appreciates us. So you pray to St. Jude too. He's another transmission guru, St. Jude. Many have prayed to St. Jude and received their answers to their prayers. He's extraordinary with that. He seems to be very good at pragmatic matters, St. Jude. Longchenpa seems to be have this capacity for intrinsic spaciousness, has tremendous capacity for the highest kinds of realizations and transmissions and experiences. We're getting real close to running out of space here. This free space, 1.3 gigs. I could always erase some, couldn't I? Watch me. Let's see if I can do that. I could find this here, click on it, and just a couple of videos already been uploaded. Just erase them. Why not? Why not do it in real time? We're not in the box anymore, are we? No, we're not. Video. In the video. There you go. Say goodbye to these. If I can do that. And you know how slow the computers can be. So I will just wait for that, you know, for it to happen. See what we can do. On the radio. I was in the store today and they're playing 80s disco music, 80s music. And it's like, I said, oh, it's so cool. Compared to like the dance, electronic dance music now. I was trying to find some background for my video, and I said, man, you know, it's just robotic. I mean, it is terrible compared to what we had back when Disco Inferno was really burning. And, you know, people criticized it and laughed, but looking back on it, that was some pretty, pretty cool music. I mean, it gets you hopping and skipping, actually. I'm in the store and I'm discoing down the aisle. Really, it's like wow. And of course, nobody else is doing it, but yeah. And I'm singing today, and I'm like doing these, you know, gestures, and I know people look in the rearview mirrors like, whoa, what the heck is this? Some maniac back there? What is it? Road rage is going on or something? Hispanics are cool. They just kind of look at you like you're crazy, but it's okay. They don't say anything. Because they don't have the juice, because they, you know, they're illegally, so they're not going to say anything. They just kind of look at you like, crazy white man, okay. Huh. But they're very cool. Hispanics are very cool. He says, maybe the white man drank too much tequila or something. I don't know, probably something like that. No big deal. They don't say, oh my God, looks like someone bipolar bully there. Oh, you know, I got to call 911 or something. They don't call 911. So, if, you know, Hispanics is looking at you, just say, you show your soul, and he goes, let a laugh, a little laugh or something. And it just doesn't bother me. They themselves have probably drank too much tequila and wandered. You know, wandering through yards and whatever. They're able to sit down underneath a bush and just sleep outside. I mean, that's, you know, so they don't really care too much about, you know, keeping up genteel appearances of corporate society. They're not really corporate anyway. They're dealing with everybody's junk. Junk this, junk this, junk this. Clean this, clean this, clean this. They're cleaning all the dust out of our homes and yards and junk, you know? They're not corporate. Yeah, corporate wants you to be in shape so they can drive you harder, you know? But, you know, get on that bike and ride, 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 ride. Hopping and skipping through the office and singing a musical as you go to your desk, you know. Me and Jesus, we got a good thing going. Me and Jesus, we got it all worked out. You know, hey, how you doing? Hey, how you are? You having a wonderful morning this morning? And they say, oh, yeah, how about you? I am on fire today. You know, it's just a glorious, miraculous day for me. I'm just receiving transmissions in my dreams. Me and Jesus. Hey, how you doing today? Lovely. Looking great, man. I think you're going to have a miraculous day today. You know, on your way to your office, your chair and your cubicle. Everybody's like, what drugs are he on? I think he went bipolar. I think he's having a bipolar episode here. Uh-oh, better call. Are you on any medication? Are you taking your meds? We got a lot of meds now that can control that sort of situation, you know? Where are the hippies that come into work like that? Just, can you dig it, sister? Wow! You know, I feel like the sunshine is just bursting all over. I mean, I feel like I am the sun itself, just radiating happiness, love, peace, and happiness. Here's a flower. And they go around passing out flowers to everyone in their cubicles in tech land, you know, in the Google headquarters. Here's a flower. And poof, yeah. Come in playing a flute. Da 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 da, passing out flowers and da 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 da. Say, ah, I feel so creative today. So I want to work a little bit. You know, the local girls are like, that's not the kind of culture we've been training you in, actually. So we need to work on that a little bit. Of course, they're so cat-like smooth about their displeasure. Because they say, don't worry, we'll grind that away. We'll get that, grind those rough edges off. No problem. We have our sly little ways of making sure culture runs exactly the way we want it to run without appearing to having done much of heavy-handed stuff at all. That's the trick of being a yoga girl. Cultural controller is you make it seem like it dies with a whimper. You know, Mr. Hippie dies with a whimper. And he thinks, what the heck was I doing? I must have been crazy back then, probably bipolar, you know. Yeah. So, you know, we do have some doctors, and we'd like you to at least check with the doctor and see, maybe you might be having some chemical imbalance. Happens to a lot of us. We've been working so hard. You've been working so hard. Your nutrition might be so good. Let's do some nutritional tests on you. I think maybe I have a deficiency of something. So it all gets back to, you know, materialism, body, materialism, chemicals, brain, a little brain imbalance. That's okay. We all could, you know, subject to that. I had a friend who had a little brain imbalance, you know, but they got the right meds and they're much better now. It's like that, you know. So we're so helpful. We're just here to be helpful. We're just here to help you get the right cultural tone. That's all. And the hippie says, I'm doing the same thing. I'm helping you get the right cultural tone. And they say, well, actually, we're the ones who decide that, not you. You know, sorry, but that's just the way it is. I nice smile, nice pleasant smile, Nurse Ratched, very nice pleasant smile. We've got a whole bunch of Nurse Ratchets in the world, running the, helping run, having spread corporate culture. Have you been drug tested lately? I'm going to take a look at your records here. Let's just see what's going on with you and get a little better profile, because some of that behavior, it's a little bit disruptive, you know, to the office culture here. And so we just want to, you know, kind of see what's going on with you here, where this is coming from, and see if we can, you know, smooth it out a little bit, because, you know, the people here, they kind of got, you know, getting a little nervous because they're not really sure what to expect. They want to kind of want to know what to expect with of one another here, and we're trying to, you know, have a happy corporate culture here. And so, you know how it is like that. So maybe you can talk to our, we have a really nice staff counselor, very pleasant people. Just, you know, have a chat with them, and we'll be, it's on our time, actually. We'll pay for it, and, you know, a nutritional counselor, and maybe an exercise counselor, and, you know, maybe get you on some probiotics. It could be, you know, some imbalance somehow, some kind. You know, they're oh so nice and oh so solicitous and oh so helpful. And oh so determined to put you under their, put your neck under their heel. And if you push back a little bit, you find out how determined they are, how frightened they are. They're terrified that there might be something beyond what they know. They're not really pioneers. They're very much don't have the pioneering spirit that they pretend to have. They're trying to limit it. They say, we know how far to go. If you go any further, you'll drop off the edge of the earth. They're flat earthers, basically. Corporate people are flat earthers, and they'll drop off the edge of the earth. So let's just stick where we are. Let's do what we can, but don't you be going into this transmission of intrinsic spaciousness thing. We can't really monetize that very well. We haven't figured out how to monetize that yet. So it's like it's an abyss, you know. It's an abyss. Hey, I got space back. I disk free space 17.48 gigabytes. So we can basically go all night, except it will stop once I reach 4 gigabytes. Of course, I could always do another video. But then I couldn't edit them together in YouTube. Unless they change it. Come on, let us do 5-hour videos here. A 2.5's a nice size. Because what we're doing here is very serious talk, actually. But, you know, being professional at it, being a pro at it, is it's all light. It's all humorous. It's all light. Because we're super confident in success, you see. We're super confident in success. But the subject matter we're talking about, I do it in a humorous way, but it's exactly what's going on, isn't it? And it's a deadly serious situation, because they don't want you to go any further than anything they can monetize, that they're expert at monetizing and monopolizing. And if they feel that you're breaking out of that mold, you know, they send for Nurse Ratched, and she shows up, plenty of lip gloss, smiling, beautiful damsel, and she's full of answers for you. And you get, guess what? It's your lucky day. You get to try this, and this. We've got a whole program to help you out. Man, let's get with it. Wow. I can't wait to help you out. And if you don't go with that, then they've got Plan B. Let you go, you know, fire you, or they've probably got other plans too, don't they? probably, they're tied in, I'm sure, with mental health professional stuff, and they may, it's not like a, quite like it used to be. It used to be pretty bad. If you cross the wrong people, they'd go to a psychiatrist, get the psychiatrist to say that you were certifiable, and you'd end up in a mental institution. That's what the corporation used to do. Yeah, we had this place called Agnew's State Hospital, notorious place. If you didn't fit the mold, and people got ticked off enough about that, you'd end up in Agnew's. They threaten you. We'll send you to Agnew's, they'd say. And a lot of hippies, did get sent to Agnew's for a while. I mean, it was a threat over our heads here. Agnew State Hospital. Agnew State Hospital. It's now closed, I believe. A lot of mental institutions are closed, but they can't force you like they used to take medications. But being fired from your job and getting on your resume that they say psychiatric problems that caused your firing, hard to get other jobs, and you kind of spiral out of the culture. They blackball you. I mean, it's they know their business. It's just more sophisticated now. So you either ship up, shape up, or they ship you out. It's always the way it is. Corporations, they. Corporate culture dominates. That's it. How do we monetize this? It's bottom line. The shareholders run the ship, run the show. Yeah, shareholders are probably trekking in Tibet. Yeah, but they'll throw you in the loony bin, if you don't keep their profits coming in. Keep monetizing it. We got shares. We're living the high life off of these shares. Oh yeah, these people are trekking all over the place doing all this stuff. They're shareholders. They get money. You wonder how these people live the lifestyle they do. They got a lot of stock. They have a lot of stock. And they've got you in a cubicle making sure that the stock prices keep going up. They don't want you, they don't want people to leave the cubicles. Yeah, I mean, it's really. I mean, the hippies, the whole thing, we've already been through it all, actually. I think we're tired of it. A lot of people have been through all this. I was smart in some ways. I don't try to yank their chain, anybody's chain, really. I say that's a waste of time. Just look, find the Dharma kings, find the transmission gurus. Get realized, and then take it from there. We'll see what's what at that point. But don't butt your head against the wall. Don't hit your head against the wall. It's just stupid. You're not going to change corporate culture. It's about monetization. And you can't monetize truth, reality at all, actually. So they hate it. Plain and simple. I mean, they're paranoid about it. And you don't think those yoga girls have stock? You better believe they have stock. They got a lot of stock. They're going to be filthy rich when they cash that stock. I mean, that's their retirement. They retire early, live off of the stock. You think they want their free enterprise bringing their company down? Or hippie movement people don't care anymore about their products? You think they want that to happen? No, when they're nurse ratcheting you. They're protecting their retirement and their good life. Retired, 40, and have, 3 or 4 houses around the world and just live the grand life, their version of it. There's tons of that around the world, tons of it. So many like that. They get a new car every couple of years. the very best sports cars or whatever. And they're, you know, vacationing so much, grandkids are volunteering. They just, you know, they do you think they're going to let a hippie get in the way of that? Not a chance in, you know what, H-E double toothpicks. You ask a guy who's watching the money in your house. Well, she is. Are you kidding me? The wife, she watches every penny. She knows exactly what's going on. Yeah, a lot of households are that way. They want the good life. They want the good life. As they see it, the materialistic good life. But is that a good life? Or is it a terrible life for a lot of people? And what's the price of getting that good life? Everybody has to buy into that this, you know, this is our goal, is what, to give the yoga girls a good life? I mean, who decided that? Our goal is to realize that all this has just been a pretense, is all pretending. That is to realize that we never fell asleep. We're spirit, we're not body. There's just one life, and our goal is to experience our freedom, our spiritual freedom. That's our goal. And who decided that? God. So God trumps the yoga girls, plain and simple. And if they don't like it, too bad. There isn't any other authority. There's no authority, some second God. There's no goddess authority that trumps God. Or they can say, well, you can have your God, but I'm going to have my goddess, and that's just a high authority. No, no, it isn't. It's no authority at all, actually. There's only one authority, and that's God. And that's the one life that is. All empowered in the now. There's no form. Nothing's ever been born. Nothing's ever died. Everything's just creative display of ornamentation of intrinsic spaciousness. And that's it. That's what is the one life is. And realization of this is the purpose we have here. Who says? God says. There is no other side to it. There's no side to it. There's no goddess side to it saying, no, 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 no. You're supposed to make the yoga girls happy because that makes the goddess happy. They just made up this goddess figure to try and assert authority over us. Say, so, no, your responsibility is to work to make my life comfortable and happy. That's your purpose in life. No, it isn't. They say, well, yeah, it is. The goddess says this. No, there is no goddess. You just made that up to try and intimidate us. But there is a God. There is the one life. And the one life says your responsibility here is to recognize the one life, the truth of it, the truth of your of being. That's your responsibility. Ram Maharshi said that very clearly. It's your only responsibility, he says. He didn't say your responsibility is to make sure the yoga girl's stock goes higher and higher and not to mess with that. He never said that. No Dharma kings ever said any such thing. So they just invent this phantom goddess who they claim is telling them that that's, you know, your job is to do that. No, that's just their greed. They're trying to sanitize their own greed and laziness. They're trying to sanitize their laziness by that ploy. Just a ploy. They're lazy. They're covetous. They're greedy. They're envious. They're arrogant. And they got actually no right to tell anybody what to do. They need to look in the mirror and stop being so lazy. And if they want to be lazy, that's their problem. You don't have to build swimming pools for them. They can build their own. If they want to be lazy, let them take care of their lazy life. That's all it is. You're either lazy or you're not lazy. And if they want to live a lazy life, then guess what? That's their responsibility. They can take care of their lazy life. Them, we're not here to take care of their lazy life. They're on their own on that one. Because they're ignoring God. And guess what? We don't want to ignore God. And if they say, well, we guess what? We can ignore God because the goddess tells us what to do. No, that just all you're saying is laziness is telling you what to do and trying to sanitize it by claiming it's coming from a goddess figure. No, it's coming from your own arrogance and laziness and continuity fear. You don't want to work on your continuity fear, then you could be lazy. So have a happy, lazy life. I'm not going to help you be lazy. Why should we help anyone be lazy? That's not compassion. Longchenpa says, practice. That's my very best heartfelt advice from you, from the bottom of my heart. I'm full from the very core of compassion. Forget about the world and all this stuff and just practice. Get to it. This is my advice to you. Don't waste your time in all this other stuff. Don't live a lazy life. Says that benefits you nothing. Doesn't give you any benefit at all. In fact, it's the reverse. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. This is a very graphic and accurate way of saying it. Because let those who worship death, let them take care of worshiping death. You don't have to help them out. You're not called to help them out on that. That's their problem. They say, well, yeah, but it's so difficult for suffering. Well, those are lessons you need to learn then. That worshiping death brings you suffering. You're responsible. If you want to live a life of death worshiping, you're responsible for the suffering, not me. You're going to have to take care of it, not me. I'm calling you to stop being lazy and start practicing, evaporating your continuity fear. That's not fair. They say, I won't believe in God anymore. We already not believing in God because you're not even practicing. You're living a lazy life. That means you're trying to ignore God. Ignoring his admonition of the one responsibility you have. You're completely ignoring his. How can you then say it's not fair, God? You're not helping me out, you know, blah, blah, blah. Hey, God's helping you out by saying stop being lazy. What else can God say? If you want to be lazy, there's nothing God can do. You're going to suffer. You're live your laziness, that's all. And all the stuff that comes with that. You, of course, the generic you, speaking to the lazy ones. Bringing this to light for everyone. Let the dead bury the dead. If they want to believe in death, then let them bury the dead. You don't have to believe in death. Those who don't believe in death, why should they spend time burying the dead? They don't have to do that. It's not their problem. They're not generating any death. So let those who believe in generating death, let them deal with death. Those who are pretending to generate death, let them pretend to fix it. Let them pretend to deal with it. The consequences. Wow, I gotta bury this and bury all this stuff. Wow. My body feels a little better. I recovered from the shock of that workout a little bit. Yeah. I think Kavita on ice or real cold on a hot day, man, that's just going to hit the spot. But if it's a kind of a cold, cool, and it's kind of warms up, it's not quite the same. It needs to be served chilled, and warm day is better. So what do we do from here? Ask for more transmissions, plain and simple. hard to see the road forward, isn't it? So just ask for transmissions and then take it from there. That's all. I'm getting much more assertive and not so easy to push around. I'm noticing that. More and more and more with the queen bees, I'm seeing how to respond to them and not get nurse ratcheted by them, which they most certainly are expert at doing. Now, when I actually have to interact with them, you go compliant because everybody expects that to you. They don't expect you to be skipping down the road, right? But at some point, we may need to start skipping down the road here. You may need to tell them that the party's over. Your little stock party's over. And I'm happy to be the one to tell you this because this is ultimately very beneficial to you. So guess what? You get to stop being lazy. There's nothing better in life than to stop being lazy, spiritually lazy. There's no greater help anyone can possibly give than inspire someone to stop being spiritually lazy. Because spiritual laziness is just an endless road of despondency. That's all it is. Whereas if you drop the laziness, It's a beautiful road of more and more hope, genuine hope, more and more clarity, more and more confidence, more and more super confidence. It's a beautiful, beautiful road. Nothing in the world can come close to it. Although some hippies might tell you, wandering through the Khyber Pass and then, you know, and from Pakistan into India or something, you know, it's like, are there somewhere in Tibet? And they say, that's wow. I say, no, it's not as good as a spiritual path. They say, yeah, but we were throwing stones out the window and into these river gorges and blossoms, we'd toss them into the river gorge. I said, yeah, but I was getting transmissions from Longchenpa. They go, well, we didn't quite get that. You know, we sang a few songs along the way. We're on the road to Shambhala. Everybody's happy and nobody's sad. Or how it goes. We're on the road to Shambhala. Whoa, ooh, ooh, ooh. Yeah. Three Dog Night, believe it or not. I can tell my brother by tell my sister by the flowers in her hair, we're on the road to Shambhala. Well, people, they did that. They'd be on the road and they're hitting in their bus, VW bus, on the road to Shambhala. Now they're playing their Range Rovers. You know, baby boomers now, they got their Range Rovers driving to Shambhala. And they'd flowers in their hair, they'd pick a flower and, you know, and here, give it to you. Yeah, I got all these flowers in my hair, I can just pass them out. And, you know, sitting on the roof of the, they've got a roof rack on the VW bus, and they, you know, you'd sit up there in your asanas and meditate as you pull over by a river gorge in the Swat Valley where Padmasambhava was from. Maybe visit the birthplace of the area where the lake where Padmasambhava appeared in a lotus flower. And you're sitting on top of the bus and you're in lotus posture. Om Mani Padme Om, Om Mani Padme Om. And you know, you're chanting all day. Of course, a lot of them thought they were the ones giving the transmissions. Oh, I wasn't supposed to say that. Yeah, they kind of, once they're on drugs, they thought, wow, I can give a trans, let me give a transmission here, I can do that. I feel really empowered by this You know, psychedelics. I'm going to give a real powerful transmission. Om Mani Padme Om. Om Mani Padme Om. Kind of on a spiritual ego trip. If you get into the drugs, it's easy to tilt that way, actually. There's a fine line. You have to be in touch with your compassion. Because we can give out empowerments, it's true. But you have to be very in touch with your compassion, and drugs mess that up. You lose the balance. You lose the fine line. You don't really are able to, you know, you lose it. You lose it. You can't afford to lose it these days. You cannot afford to lose it. These nurse ratchets are ready to throw us all in the loony bin, actually. They're preaching this thing, you know, just everybody's now diagnosing everybody with, you're bipolar. I think you're bipolar. If you do anything they don't like, this is like, has anyone told you that you might be bipolar? Have you thought about it? Do you ever check for being bipolar, 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 bipolar? I'd say, have you ever checked for being a zombie fascist? You ever checked for that? Have you ever been checked for the disease of trying to control people through misdiagnosing them? You ever been checked for bullying and intimidating people by implicating their free and intelligent behavior as bipolar? But I mean, we're in a situation similar back when the hippie thing started, where hippies were extremely intimidated. People tried to intimidate them, extremely intimidate them. You know, you're mentally ill. You flipped out. We'll send you the Agnews. It's terrible. We're right back in that spot, if not worse than ever. Because back then it was the men mostly that the wives told them, get that guy, you know, guy's messing with, you know, our stock, get him in the loony bin. The man would crack the whip, but then the hippies would say, hey, man, you know, you trying to tell me what to do? I'll punch you in the face. You want to get punched in the face? I mean, I'm not going to tell you what to do. I mean, so the men will stand up to other men. And then the other man would back down and say, well, you know, I'm not really sure that you're bipolar. My wife wants me to do this, but I don't really want to get punched in the face. So, you know, well, just, you know, don't cause so much trouble. You know, don't make things tough on me. Now the wife's thinking, I'm gonna have how many grandkids? Probably like 15 grandkids. They got their whole life mapped out. Like, I want this much money at this age, this much money at this age, and then we're going to do vacationing here. We'll have the grandkids giving them, you know, college. We'll pay for grandkids' college and all this stuff. So they've got your whole life mapped out for you. And you're just supposed to make as much money as possible so they can play fairy godmother. And the kids will say, oh, Grandma, you're so wonderful. We really believe in your culture that you're preaching for us. It's look, all the gifts we get from you. So yeah, nobody questions it when the yoga girls are playing fairy godmother to everybody off of the death of their husbands for working themselves to death, trying to just make as much money as possible, never stopping for a second to throw a flower in the air. This is the situation now. It's horrible right now. They want to be able to give all these, you know, bequeath this to their grandchildren. This is just, so yeah, get that's your job, or your life's already accounted for. It's my children and my grandchildren that you have to be serving now. So wait a minute, isn't a better way to serve the grandchildren is to get them on the spiritual path and to teach the way of no laziness and be super focused on right spiritual skillful means, right spiritual practice, so they be liberated from the false belief that they ever fell asleep in the first place, and so they be able to experience the one life and realize they're not body at all. They've never been a body. Isn't that way better bequeathment to your grandchildren? And they say, and they'll say, I'm pretty sure you're very bipolar now. And they say, well, I'm pretty sure you're like very lazy. You're suffering from the worst illness possible. It's called laziness. So then you dream up all these excuses to have everybody else serve your laziness. So if anybody needs to be committed, you need to be committed to the Laziness Institution. How about that? So, all homage to the Dharma Kings, the Root Guru, the Transmission Guru, the Big Boost Guru, and the Inspirational Guru. And, of course, all coming from the Holy Spirit, which comes from God the Father, the One Life, the One Life, the One Life, without any other life, without a second life. There's just the One Life, and all of it is eternal. And that can be realized, and that's our one responsibility, and that's it. Laziness need not apply here. I think laziness is bipolar, actually.